Now, normally I'm really humble and respectful and polite when it comes to people who, make videos about me. But this guy in particular, I asked him politely to stop, being annoying and putting my content on his channel, with not very much context. And, he didn't listen. He continues to do it. You've been effing with me since 2020, and I've been repeatedly telling you to leave me alone. He's made four videos about me that I know of, and I asked him kindly to stop, but he didn't do it. So now I have to completely and utterly annihilate and destroy him in this particular video because I have studied geography and geology all my life. I was always interested in it since I was a child. I've always been interested in maps. I used to walk around the neighborhood with a piece of paper and like map out my neighborhood, draw it out. I've always been interested in that since I was a child, bruh. So now you're gonna see what I'm talking about. Watch how I utterly destroy you.
False doctrine. This false doctrine got you going off the deep end, got you in the book of Theosophists, got you real desperate and all of that, man. All twisted up, man. What is Theosophists? The teaching about God and the world based on mystical insight, often capitalized the teaching of a modern movement. A shoot. Originating in the U.S. in 1875 and following chiefly Buddhist and Brahmanic theories, especially of pantheistic evolution and reincarnation. You need to repent.
Let's not be naive here. He's pretending that I use the Theosophist like it's a major source for me. I literally only used the book once and literally have only read one page of the book. I found it through Google Books. When you use Google Books, you only type in a keyword and it shows you a book. It's an occult book. What is the occult, Calvin? Do you know? The occult is the elites, right? So the elites are telling us in their book that they hid, that is now open to the public, that they found Negroes in America. You skip past that. You skip past that.
Now, let's get to the truth. What type of jewelry did Native Americans wear? They wore carved wood, animal bones, claws, and teeth were made into beads, which were then sewn into clothing or strung into necklaces. All right. Yeah, they wore turquoise, like you're starting to wear turquoise.
I hate it when people think all indigenous Americans are one race of people. When in Eurasia, you can find multiple races of people. When in Africa, you can find multiple ethnicities of people. Why do you think in America, you can only find one ethnicity, one genetic backbone of people? That doesn't matter. It doesn't make sense. It says there were, this is the book American Nations, Volume 1, page 26. There were formerly in America, as now, tribes of all complexions, as elsewhere, yellowish, olive, coppery, tawny, red and brown, incarnate or white, and even blackened or Negro-like, tall and dwarfish men from 8 to 4 feet in size, called giants and pygmies, men with various frames, skulls, and features. The Americas had, long before Columbus, large cities built of stones, brick, or wood, walls, ditches, temples, and palaces, some of which were of immense size and population. Then when we go down, it says nearly all ancient sciences and useful primitive arts were known in America, as well as commerce and navigation, symbolic alphabetic writing, and nearly all Asiatic religions. The most civilized nations had even colleges and universities, canals and paved roads, splendid temples and monuments, etc. So what does that tell you? You can't just have a huge landmass of people with immense population and they're all dumb. What determines whether or not a group of people is advanced or if they are primitive? population. Population is really the only thing that determines whether a population is going to be advanced in technology or primitive in technology. If you look at islands around the world, the native people of the islands are very primitive because those populations are very small. If you look at places in the world that have huge populations, they have more advanced technology because there are more brains. And as we know, two brains are smarter than one. The more brains you put together, the more technology you will have. Any place on Earth where there's a lot of people, you have advancements in technology, architecture, and other achievements that you won't find in places where there's a little population.
Exodus 32:2. And Aaron said unto them, break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. So we see right here that the ancient Israelites, they wore gold jewelry. And we saw that the ancient Native American Indians, they did not wear gold jewelry.
Oh, yeah. You remember who you are? Decked out in gold? Look at that. Decked out in gold.
Okay. What did Native Americans think of gold? Tragically, while many in the Native American population knew where gold was, few valued it for anything. There were some that later found it useful to trade with settlers, Edomites, but most viewed it as nothing more than a shining piece of earth.
Bro said ancient Native Americans did not have any gold. They did not have any use for gold because he blindly believed what he saw off of a Google search. Somebody tell him that a Google search is not a source. Can somebody tell him that Google search is not a source? Somebody can easily write anything on Google. So you have to be able to backhand it with a primary source or an eyewitness to be able to see whether or not what they're saying is accurate. So obviously, here are some pictures of Native American artifacts that were clearly made of gold. Like, it's a well-known fact that Native Americans dealt heavily with gold. It's nothing to be surprised for. It's a golden gauntlet for the arm, right? This is in the Museum of the American Indian. Here's a book called Observation on a Gold Ornament from Florida. The composition of the gold plate from which the specimen is made indicates it's of post-Columbian origin. The proportion is 893 parts of gold and 107 parts of silver. So they use gold and silver. And where was this? This was in Florida. This is from a book called The American Antiquarian and Oriental Journal. Let's look at the bottom paragraph. It says, the cupidity of the Indian for gold is strong. I'm gonna repeat. It says, the cupidity of the Indian for gold is strong, and he would eagerly search for it on the slightest indication of its presence. The Indian would search for gold on the slightest indication. If they sniff that there might be gold in the area, they're going to be digging for that gold. The cupidity of the Indian for gold. Didn't he say from that Google search, according to the government? He used a government source. He believes the government. He might as well put on a mask and get the vaccine, because that source that he used, the Bureau of Gold, U.S. Bureau of Gold, that's a government website. Cupidity means greed for money or possessions. So it says the cupidity of the Indian for gold is strong, and he would eagerly search for it on the slightest indication of his presence. If you look at many of the old pictures of Americans, you're going to see that they surrounded by gold. This dude right here got a gold pipe that he's smoking tobacco out of. The crown on his head is gold. He got gold nuggets on him, around him. He have golden coins in a barrel around him. And behind him, there is a castle that is made of gold. People don't even realize how much and how heavily we've been lied to about, you know, the indigenous American culture. We think that, you know, everybody was just in teepees and huts, when in reality, we had advanced architecture. Man, just look at these old American Indian figurines, man. They're always dealing with gold, bro. You know, they only sculpted what they saw. They're not just going to make up this stuff. Look at this one. He got golden, he got a gold chain on his neck, man. You think this stuff is just, you think all this is a coincidence? You think they just lined it? No, they sculpted the stuff that they saw. They sculpted the stuff that they saw. This thing ain't no bigger than a toy that we used to play with as children. And it costs $57,381.14, bro. Why they charging so much? Because it's the truth. And you know they can't let everybody know about the truth. They don't want Negroes to have this, because it's going to remind them that they are the original people of the Americas. Now, this may very well be one of my ancestors, Gary Kugi. She was an Anianwia princess. Look how she dressed. She had a crown on her head. Beautiful woven fabric on her body. Dark chocolate skin. Can't make this stuff up, man. I really can't make this up, man. Again, another depiction of Aboriginal American statue in France, because you know they ain't gonna have this in America. And what is he wearing? Gold collars, gold armbands. Come on, man. He even blowing a gold shofar.
And we see that the Egyptians on the Eastern Hemisphere was the first to ever wear gold. And we see that gold was first found in California in the 1800s. So the Americas wasn't known for gold till 1848. 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 1848. 1848. And the Egyptians on the Eastern Hemisphere was wearing gold 6,000 years ago. That's a cut. Okay, well, what was the currency of the ancient Native American Indians? Wampum, tubular shell beads that have been assembled into strings or woven into belts or embroidered ornaments. All right. This is what wampum looks like. Early American currency. Beaded work. All right. Now, what did the ancient Israelites use for currency? 1 Chronicles 21 and 25. So David gave to Ornan for the place 600 shekels of gold by weight. So no, the Israelites, the ancient Israelites, we're not using shells and beads, purple shells and all of that for currency. The ancient Israelites were using gold. And ancient America was not known for gold at that time. And ancient America was not known for gold at that time. And ancient America was not known for gold at that time. And all of these jewels on the ephod? Yeah. That got to be in the earth wherever the Holy Land is.
Ancient America was not known for gold at that time.
School of Arts magazine, Applied Art Book, Metal and Jewelry, Volume 22. No other people, and they put no other in all caps, in the history of the world ever used gold ornaments as did the American Indians. Wow. Columbus arrived at the Bay of Cerbero. He saw natives wearing neck ornaments of base gold in the form of eagles, lions, and other beasts and fowls. From the house of a chief, his followers took gold plates like eagles. Later on, the white man met Indians wearing gold plates suspended from their noses. On the West Coast was discovered gold in the shape of bracelets, collars, earrings, breastplates, helmets, and certain berries wherewith the women bear up their breasts. Fateful was the day for the American Indians when the strangers came and saw the glitter of the precious yellow metal on every side. So everywhere they turned, they saw gold, man. And they're going to tell you they didn't even have a use for gold. They lied. Why do you think it's so important for them to lie to you about the American Indians? Because they don't want you to know something. America is the most lied to you about continent on the face of the earth, and there's a reason why. In 1513, when Balboa sighted the Pacific from a mountain peak in Darien, he learned of a great Indian empire to the southward where pure gold was said to be used for the construction of ordinary household utensils. That's how common gold was. So don't trust this man. He doesn't know what he's talking about. He's not using primary sources.
All of these stones are rare except for the beryl and the jasper. Those are common. Those are found all over the world. But the rest of them are very rare and found only in the ground on the Eastern Hemisphere. The rest of them are very rare and found only in the ground on the Eastern Hemisphere. The rest of them are very rare and found only in the ground on the Eastern Hemisphere.
Now let's go into a book called The Mining of Gems and Ornamental Stones by American Indians by Sidney H. Ball. So it's talking about the mining of the American Indians. He said American Indians didn't do nothing with any types of gemstones because all they had was turquoise. That's what happens when you only use Google and you don't deal with firsthand eyewitness accounts. You don't deal with any primary sources. You're dealing with regurgitated bullish. I repeat on my channel over and over, and I know he's seen and heard me say this, that history was changed in 1846. If you're looking at things from after 1846, it may indeed have bullshit in it. And he's looking from Google searches, which is no older than 25 years old. Everything on Google is no older than 25 years old. And you're telling me that that's your sources? That's your sources? Come on, man. So agatized wood, what is agatized wood? Agatized wood is wood that petrified and eventually turned into a gate stone, right? The wood got so old and dry that it turned to stone. It said agatized wood was used by the Indians from Oregon and Wyoming. The petrified forest near the Animas Ariz was known to the Indians and particularly to the Pueblos, a source of agatized wood. Amethyst, so they use amethyst that's on the holy breastplate. Smoky quartz and other members of the quartz family. Now these are the Pueblo Indian. These are the Mongoloid Native Americans. Those ain't even the people that we are. I told you it's multiple different types of Native Americans. It's multiple different types of people that was living here before the white man showed up. It wasn't just one race. If there's somebody got murdered, right? Somebody got murdered. There's an eyewitness and then there's a person who heard about the murder. Who are the police going to trust? Are they going to trust about the guy that heard about the murder from his friend? Or is the police going to trust the eyewitness? The eyewitness is the person the police is going to go to first because the eyewitness actually experienced it. Not the person who just heard about it from a rumor from his friend. So why would you go to Google to try to find knowledge and not go to primary sources, eyewitness accounts? You know what I'm saying? Those are the trustworthy sources, not random sites on Google, and definitely not government sites, definitely not the Smithsonian, definitely not National Geographic, definitely not the Bureau of Gold. You know, don't trust any government affiliated websites. And Wikipedia is the first one that you use. Wikipedia is kind of trustworthy because most of the time they use primary sources. But again, Wikipedia is not even 20 years old. Azurite and Malachite. Azurite and Malachite, some argue that Azurite and Malachite was on the breastplate, depending on the translation that you're reading. Specifically Malachite, they say Malachite was a stone on the breastplate, the stone of Levi, that is. Malachite was used by the Indians of Arizona and New Mexico, by the Aztecs, Mayas, and Peruvians, by the Indians of British Columbia, Eastern Canada, Ecuador, Colombia, Bolivia, Argentina. Azurite was used by the Pueblo, Eskimo, and Mayas, and the Indians of Bolivia, Eastern Canada, San Domingo, and Chile. Come on. Let's look at Jasper. Jasper was also quarried in Chester and Lancaster counties, Flint Ridge and Licking and Muskingum counties, Ohio. It is a site of Aboriginal flint quarries, affording also Jasper and Chelonidy, which cover an acre of 2 square miles. And the cavities of the flint are quartz crystals up to 1 and 2 inches across. So it tells you all the places that the American Indians mined Jasper. And then it talks about the Aztec Jasper mines, right? In the second paragraph, right? Again, amethyst. The Aztecs had some amethyst of fine color. Finer, I am inclined to believe, than that of any of the Mexican sources we know. The Aztecs even had amethyst mines. But anyway, let's talk about rock crystal, also known as quartz. You know, quartz, some translations will say that diamond was actually quartz on the breastplate, but you know, it might also be diamond. But let's read about quartz anyway. It was mined by the American Indians of the Appalachian Mountains of Virginia and North Carolina. It must have been a byproduct of mica mining. Quartz was indeed quarried at many places in the pediment region of the southeastern states, but since here, as elsewhere, it occurs so frequently as pebbles, gravels were the main source. God damn, it tells you that quartz in that area occurs at just as much as pebbles. See, it says about 1563, the Indians brought the Frenchmen presents of pearls, crystals, silver, etc. Now let's look at beryl, which was also on the breastplate. Beryl was not infrequently used by the Aztecs and is one of the minerals mentioned in the Aztec Book of Tribute. He said all this stuff is found in Italy and You know, none of the Middle East, though. He used Italy and Myanmar and what he used, France. He used goddamn India. But none of that stuff is even in the Middle East, man. You're not proving your point. But since you use the entire Eastern Hemisphere, I'm going to use the entire Western Hemisphere. So I'm not just going to stick to Western North America. I'm going to talk about the Aztecs. I'm going to talk about the Peruvians, right? The entire Western Hemisphere used these crystals, man. It's very simple, right? It's very, very simple. They even found beryl. They even found a crystal of golden beryl in the middle of the paragraph. A crystal of golden beryl from an Indian mound near Tennessee Creek. Come on, man. Come on, man. So used by the Panamanians, Peruvians, and Brazilian Indians. Oh, hell no. Come on, man. Then we talking about cordinum, ruby, and sapphire. This is stuff on the breastplate. Ruby is the first crystal on the breastplate. It's also known as sardius, right? Sardius, red crystal, the ruby, right? And it said, a ruby bead found in a Cherokee Indian grave of Western North Carolina. Come on. He apparently believes it to be of Indian workmanship and noted that the tribes and noted that rubies occur in that part of the state. Ain't ruby one of the hardest crystals? And they shaped it? Come on. They shaped it into beads. Into beads. What kind of technology did these people have? People, like, y'all gotta stop being so stupid and brainwashed, man. Like, this is stuff that people don't understand. And it's simple, it's right in front of your face. Now, when we're talking about emerald, emerald was used by the Indians of Colombia, Venezuela, Ecuador, Bolivia, Peru, Brazil, and Panama. Among Peruvian Indians under the Incas, the emerald called Unama was the king of gems, even the turquoise being not so much esteemed by the Indians. Come on, man. They tell you turquoise was the best one. Now, turquoise was the stone of the Cherokee. That's why I wear turquoise, because my ancestors are Anayanwia. Anyway, diamond. We're gonna get into diamond. Even the diamond was mined by Indians in Brazil. It says were used, as it was said by the Indians, as playthings for children. That's how common it was. Our ancestors in America was really looking full of gold, just like he talking about we was full of gold. Hell yeah, we was full of gold, man. Hell yeah, we was full of gold. Even the women was full of gold. We had so much gold, the women was wearing gold as makeup, man. They ground up gold into powder and put it on their face like it's makeup. Y'all not even understanding. He said there was no crystal use. Look at this big ass cluster of emerald that the Timucua Indians would mine and wear on their breastplates. On their breastplates. Their breastplates was laid with gold, just like the breastplate. It's like the Levitical breastplates. Come on, where did they get that from? I don't know. It looked familiar to me. But that's a chunk of emerald that he's holding. Come on. This was actually sculpted in 1723. It's a very old statue. People think it's just a figurine. No, this is a statue. And it was made by a European man, and who found out about the glory of America. He wanted to sculpt it. He wanted to sculpt this beauty and capture it. You know what I'm saying? I'm glad that he did that before it was erased. I'm glad he did that before it was erased. Like, this is the Timucuas, man. This is how the Timucua look. See, this is a Timucua. Look at his arms. The exact same. Look at his head. Look at his breastplate. Watch this. Look at that. Look what he got on his arm. The exact same thing. He even got the tattoos. Don't they have tattoos on their body? Come on. This is Timucuas. This is him. This is the 1724 version. This is a 1900 drawing for children. This is a 1700s version. 1900, 1700, 1900, 1700, 1900s. Of course, they're going to tell you that these people were not black. When everywhere on earth, the aboriginals were black. You're going to tell me the second largest continent, which really might be the first largest continent on earth, was home to a whole bunch of Asians? While every other continent was home to Negroes, including Asia. If you look at the original Asians, the original Chinese, the original Japanese, these were Negroes with Afros and Afro picks in their hand, man. And you're going to tell me that even the Asians was black. You're going to tell me that the Americas was full of white Asians? Come on, man. Y'all brainwashed in the shows. Let's find all the gemstones on a breastplate real quick, right? In California alone, I'm just going to use California alone. You can do the same thing with Utah. You can do the same thing with Colorado. You can do the same thing with Nevada. But I want to keep it all in one state to show you that that Western North America is full of gemstones, full of crystals, actually more than anywhere else on earth. And people don't realize that. I'm going to use California alone to show you that it's full of gemstones. The earth there is full of gemstones. I mean, the Sinai Desert is in Southern California anyway. So when they told them, to find these stones, they was looking around in California anyway. So let's see if we can find this stuff in California. Can you find diamonds in California? It says, although California has produced over 600 diamonds, and you might say, well, that's not a lot, only 600 diamonds. If you continue reading, you'll see that these diamonds were some of the largest diamonds ever discovered. Large diamonds in Trinity County, California. These were some of the largest diamonds ever discovered. This is California, all right? When we're dealing with topaz, where's topaz found in California? Topaz is located on the very northern tip of Mono County. Come on, man. Then we looking at, where's a gate found in California? It gives a whole bunch of places where you can find a gate. Then when you look at where's emerald found in California, it gives you a place where you can dig for emerald. When you look at where sapphire found in California, it gives you a place where you can dig for sapphire, right? When you look up where's rubies found in California, Cascade Canyon Ruby Crystals, a Los Angeles hidden gem. Come on, man. Then when you look up, where's lapis lazuli? Lapis lazuli was the real linger stone, right, on the breastplate. San Bernardino County, California. When you look up, where's amethyst found in California? Purple Heart Mine, California. Come on. When you look at, where can onyx stone be found in California? Ribbon Rock Prospect Onyx Mine. All right, then when you look up most important gemstone resources, a world map, where's all the gemstones in North America? They all just so happen to be in Western North America. They all just so happen to be in Western North America. Western North America, it has the most gemstones, but what do we see in the Middle East? We see emptiness. What do we see in the Middle East? We see emptiness. What do we see in the Middle East? We see emptiness. There's nothing there, but in Western North America, it's full of crystals, full of gemstones, right? So I don't want to hear nothing else from this man. He doesn't know what he's talking about. Very uneducated. He's actually making up things as he goes. Number of isolated tribes of dark complexion found widely scattered among the inhabitants of North and South America.
Yeah, read it. You see what it says.
Supposed to have been immigrants from Africa prior to European discovery of America. That's false.
Nah, little homie, you're false. Read it right. Yamasi or Jamasi, Jama, Jama is a word from an African language. Jama means black. It's Swahili.
Jama means black. It's Swahili.
Jama means black. It's Swahili.
Oh my God, bro.
Oh, hell no, man. What the?
How are you going to bring out a book to prove your point, but the book that you brought out to prove your point goes against the very point that you're trying to prove? It reads, the Jamasi were one of a small number of isolated tribes of dark complexion found widely scattered among the inhabitants of North and South America, supposed to have been immigrants from Africa. Prior to the European discovery of America. Understand that. Alright? Now you can buy all these books. Buy all the copies of these books and scribble out where they came from Africa. It's not going to change the facts. Understand that. You need to repent. Stop.
I'm not going to let Calvin sit up here and cherry pick what I presented. That book is basically just the different perspectives of different settlers when they came to America, different conquistadors, different explorers, and, you know, different authors, right? And all these authors describe the American Indians, the dark-skinned. One source even said that they were so black that they are purple. And, you know, they talk about them having curly hair, copper skin, complexion, chestnut color, looking like the Ethiopians. But he skipped past all of that just to go to the very last source in the book, which was a modern source written very recently, not even a firsthand eyewitness source. He's allergic to eyewitness sources. He uses that. And it says supposed to have been from Africa. Clearly cannot sense a hijack. Doesn't even know how to sense a hijack. If they're from Africa, show me the African language that they speak. The white man does investigate. And if he has a theory, he'll investigate it. So I know for a fact the white man investigated the tribe to see if they have African language, but they found nothing. But he made up a African word. The only African language that he could think of, Swahili, which is a language spoken on East Africa, not West. So it wouldn't even make sense for them to come to America and say, oh, it means black in Swahili. Oh, man, you really messed up there. Because why would a black nation call themselves black? That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. So let's learn about the discovery of the cities of Cibola. This is talking about the first major city of Cibola. Missionary Marco de Niza saw advanced civilizations in Western North America toward Cibola, cities of gold and precious jewels. This is the book, America, being the latest and most accurate description of the New World, right? And look at the picture, all those Negroes, look at that building in the background. Looks very similar to what we call Jerusalem, right? Now, that's a Hebrew, by the way, this is a Hebrew style building. We had to put battlement at the top of our roof, right? Now, when we read this, this is talking about one of the cities of Cibola, right? When Marco de Niza was exploring, he found this, and this is what he said about this area. This was in northern Arizona, the first city of Cibola he found, northern Arizona. Much about the same time, Marco de Niza, a Franciscan, undertaking a voyage in these parts, reported wonders at his return of plenty of gold in mines, so the Indians were already digging mines when he got there. Stately cities set out with magnificent buildings, the very gates whereof were enriched with turquoise. The gates were made out of turquoise, but not just turquoise. What else? And other precious stones. So other precious stones. And the whole meanest inhabitants were glittering in gold and mother of pearl. They were glittering in gold. These people were walking around glittering in gold, bro. Like, I really don't know what else to say other than you've been lied to and you need to start digging in primary eyewitness sources. This book was written in 1671. When the ink touched the paper, George Washington, daddy, was a baby. This is a very old book. It's a primary source. So this is a worldwide gold map. As you can see, the greatest range of gold on the entire face of the earth is in North, Central, and South America. It's the longest distribution. For mile, it stretches throughout the entire western coast of the Americas. That's greater than anywhere else on earth. Even greater in distance from the golden distribution from Spain to Cambodia, that as we see in the east, is even bigger than that. It's going from Alaska down to Chile. And then here's the thing, man. All that stuff just so happens to be in Western North America as well. It almost looks like when y'all was sprinkling gold on this earth, because gold is not from the earth. Gold comes from the heavens. I just want you to know, gold comes from the heavens. It is not natural for the earth to have gold. It comes from the heavens. So when y'all was sprinkling down gold, he was putting it in America's first. Very clear and obvious. It's the largest, you know, distribution is in the Americas. Then he was like, oh wait, you know, I don't want to just have it in America. So he started putting it in other places too. That's what it looks like. I'm just saying. Now, that's why we fight for gold. That's why we die for gold. That's why black people, who wears gold today? Who's the only people on earth wearing gold today? Negroes. Just like they describe the Indians to really have a cupidity for gold. You know, just like you said, ain't nobody dying over no turquoise chain. Like he was trying to make fun of me. He said, ain't nobody dying over no one palm bead. Ain't nobody in the hood dying over no one palm bead. Because we wasn't using one palm. That was the Mongoloid. We was using that gold, man. Hell yeah. Gold is what connects us to the heavens.